grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Please stand for the call to worship. We are blessed when we hunger for justice and thirst for righteousness.
Our souls are filled with God's hope and grace.
We are blessed when we grieve over the brokenness of the world.
Choosing as God does to be with those who are weak and powerless.
We are blessed when we become God's fools.
Willing to do what is right, not what is easy to do.
Our hymn of praise is Open Our Eyes, Lord.
We'll sing this twice. Let us conclude our prayer of confession together. Forgive us by the power of your mercy, that we might stand in the goodness of Christ and walk in the light of love. Amen. Sisters and brothers, your sins are forgiven by the faith of Christ, who chose to love our hatred and forgiveness over blame.
We rejoice and are glad that God's mercy is great.
Jesus brings healing, justice, and peace.
Thanks be to God.
Prayer for illumination. Holy God,
your blessings are abundant. and your wisdom exceeds our grasp. Fill us with your Spirit, and with your word this day, that we may be justice seekers and peace makers, sharing your life among those who are forgotten, weak, or persecuted, and revealing to all your glory. Amen.
Our first scripture reading from the Old Testament, Psalm 15. We will be reading responsively. I will read the odd verses, and you will read the even verses. Let us read the word of the Lord. Lord, who may dwell in your sacred tent? Who may live on your holy mountain?
The one who walks is blameless, who does what is righteous, who speaks the truth from their heart,
whose tongue utters no slander, who does no wrong to a neighbor, and casts no slur on others.
Who despises a vile person, but honors those who fear the Lord, who keeps an oath even when it hurts, and does not change their mind.
Who lends money to the poor without interest, who does not accept a bribe against the innocent. Whoever does these things will never be shaken. This concludes our Old Testament reading.
Our gospel lesson this morning is from Matthew 5, verses 1 through 12. It's on the other side of your scripture sheet of paper. Let us hear the word of the Lord. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because God is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
At the end of the film classic, It's a Wonderful Life, George Bailey is standing in the midst of the cheering crowd of friends and neighbors. Nearby are his wife and his children. George has just had a close call. He has barely escaped a serious charge of bank fraud. George's uncle lost a large deposit. Since George was the responsible party, the loss was his to account for, his reputation and the future of the savings and loan he owned were both at risk. As he faced the prospect of losing everything, he contemplated suicide. Only the intervention of an angel named Clarence prevented George from taking his own life. Clarence pretended to be drowning, and George jumped in to save him. For the rest of George's problems, his friends and family came to his rescue. As soon as they heard what was happening, they replaced the lost funds with money from their own pockets. Their loving action saved George and his family business. As he stands in the middle of what has become a huge Christmas party in his house, George says, "I am the luckiest man alive." Well, let's challenge George's assessment of his life situation for just a moment. The dictionary defines luck as a force that brings fortune or adversity. Hence, we have good luck and bad luck. If we wanted to use luck as theme for George's situation, we could say it was bad luck
that allowed the money to be lost in the first place, and good luck that his friends were willing and able to bail him out just ahead of the bank exams. But does luck really explain what happened to George? For two generations, his family had operated the savings and loan in the town where he lived. Their customers were working families and low-income folks, including the elderly and the disabled. George's willingness to trust people and help them out when they were in trouble had earned him the respect and admiration of the whole town. George had also been sacrificial in his relations with his family. He missed going to college and traveling so that a younger brother could serve in the military in a time of war. He even postponed his own honeymoon to help calm a financial panic. George was not lucky. George was blessed. He was blessed with compassion and good sense. He was blessed with good friends and a caring family. He was blessed with integrity and wisdom. Listen to those words again. Compassion, good sense, good friends, caring family, integrity, wisdom. These blessings in George's life did not come to him floating out of the sky. He did not find these blessings in a basket on his porch. These blessings were present in George's life as a direct result of choices George had made and values he had adapted. In this sense, what happened to George at the end of the movie should not have come as a surprise. The responses he received from his friends and neighbors were a direct result of the choices he had made and the values he lived out. If we wanted to step back and comment on that final scene of the movie, we might look at George and say, "Congratulations, George. The good things you have put in motion in your life are coming back to you." Thinking about it, it's a wonderful life in these terms provides a good foundation for understanding the Beatitudes. The blessings serve as an introduction to the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew seems to have structured both the setting, the crowd gathered on a high place, and the material in a way that presents Jesus as the new Moses. If this was Matthew's intention, then the Beatitudes would correspond roughly to the new commandments. In fact, the Beatitudes have sometimes been referred to as the new law. But they are not really commandments. They are blessings. But what does that mean? There have been many efforts to find just the right word to translate the Greek word makarios. One of the most common renderings is happy. But that does not make much sense. Happy are they that mourn. Happy are they who are persecuted for doing the right thing. Really. Taking our cue from George Bailey, it seems congratulations is a much better way of hearing what Jesus is saying. Using the word congratulation keeps before us the sense of something conferred upon us. Jesus pronounces a congratulatory word for our willingness or ability to accomplish some deed or adopt some value. In other words, the use of congratulation strikes an appropriate balance between what we have done and what God is doing. For instance, some of the Beatitudes are the results of choices made and values adapted. Congratulations to the self-disciplined, the meek. Congratulations to those who mourn. Congratulations to those pure in heart. Congratulations to those who show mercy. Congratulations to those who hunger and thirst after the right. Congratulations to those who are peacemakers. Ah, but some of the Beatitudes reflect situations over which we have no control. They are situations that in some cases may be scorned. But Jesus makes them an occasion for congratulations. Congratulations to those who are poor in spirit. Congratulations to those who are persecuted for doing what is right. Congratulations to those who are reviled and slandered falsely. Jesus' use of this expression is an acknowledgement that God not only sees our situation, but in these particular instances, God affirms us. Jesus is not praising us for finding a way to earn God's favor. There is no sense that salvation is conferred upon those who do these things. Jesus is not saying that we should or that we ought to do something. He merely affirms them as they are present in our lives and indicates why they are important by pointing out where these qualities will lead. To be congratulated are the meek. Jesus affirms our self-discipline. He knows that it is the disciples of the world that will end up getting things done, inherit the earth. Our capacity to mourn is affirmed. Only through the appropriate expression of grief can comfort come. Our focused desire to have and do the right things are affirmed. Jesus knows that people who seek for what is truly worth having in life are the only people who really appreciate life and find it fulfilling. Our willingness to show mercy is affirmed. Jesus knows that a heart closed to others cannot receive the mercy he has for us. Our commitment to doing peace in our world is affirmed. Jesus knows that our only hope for a real family of human beings rests in our willingness to live with each other in peace. Our desire for our motives and actions to be consistent is affirmed, pure in heart. Jesus knows that people with this kind of integrity are most open to his presence. Being poor is not a sign of God's absence, as some in the ancient world may have believed. There is an advantage to being poor. We are to be congratulated. We, of all people, have learned to depend on God. In fact, God affirms us when our values and our actions on behalf of what is right brings wrath from the powers that be. Angry responses to our acts of faithfulness by forces and institutions that practice injustice in our world serve as a judgment on those very forces. Their effect to silence us and punish us demonstrate the depth of the evil in them. We have only to think of the civil rights movement in our country or the struggle for equality in South Africa to know the truth of Jesus's insight. We might think that our lives are governed by love, luck, subject to whatever fortunes or adversities chance bring our way. Or we might believe we are governed by some predestined script that we are all living out, each of us acting out the parts written for us. But neither luck nor fate allows for any congratulations. Congratulations are only appropriate in the world where we may choose our lives, choose our actions, and choose our value. There are consequences and benefits depending on what choices we make and what values we adapt. In the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus affirms those attitudes and actions that mark us out as God's children when they are present in our lives. We are to be congratulated. Maybe we should add a new one. Blessed are those who are congratulated by God. It means they have been listening, learning, and making the right choices. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Our hymn of response is Not Jesus Calls Us, it's For All the Saints. Let us stand and lift up our voices. God, whose wisdom surpasses our understanding, help us to grow as a people of blessing as we offer our prayers for the church and the world. We pray for those who mourn. May they know the comfort of your abiding presence. We pray for the meek. May they receive the goodness of your earth. We pray for those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. May they be filled with goodness. We pray for those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. May they be filled with goodness. And we also pray for those who are merciful, may they also receive mercy. We pray for the pure in heart. May they see you face to face. We pray for the peacemakers. May they be recognized as your children. We pray this day and give thanks for the many blessings in this life and for the gift of heaven, which is ours even now. May we, with your prophets from all the ages, have the wisdom to pursue your truth and the courage to do what is holy. We ask all this in the name of Christ, who is our light and our life, and who taught us to pray by saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We are called by the Holy Spirit. Christ has marked us as our own, and we are called into the Church of Jesus Christ by baptism. This is our common calling, to be disciples and servants of our servant Lord. Within the community of the Church, some are called to particular service.
Representing the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, the session of Fairfield Presbyterian Church, Fairfield, Florida, installees Lila Matthews, Lou Petty, and Ryan Chance to active service in this congregation.
As God calls some to a particular form of ministry, God calls us all to bear gladly the yoke of Christ, given in the covenant. Let us therefore reaffirm our baptismal vows, renouncing all that oppose God and God's rule, and affirming the faith of the Holy Catholic Church. With the whole Church, let us confess our faith by saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he was raised from the dead. He descended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In baptism, you were claimed by the love of God, clothed in the grace of Jesus Christ, and anointed with the gifts of the Holy Spirit to share Christ's mission in the world. Now you are called by God through the voice of the Church for new service and ministry in Jesus Christ. In accordance with the Constitution of the Presbyterian Church USA, show your commitment by answering these questions. Do
Do you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, your Savior? Acknowledge him of all, Lord of all, and head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. If so, say, I do.
I do.
Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testament to be by the Holy Spirit the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the Church Universal and God's Word to you?
I do. I do.
Do you sincerely receive and adapt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by these confessions as you lead the people of God?
I do, and I will.
Will you fulfill your ministry in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you be governed by our church's policy, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them subject to the ordering of God's Word and Spirit? Will you, in your own life, seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work with the reconciliation of the world?
Amen.
Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church?
Amen.
Will you pray for and seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love?
Amen.
Will you be a faithful ruling elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in councils of the church, and in your ministry? Will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ?
I will.
Do we, the members of the church, accept Leela, Lou, and Ryan as ruling elders chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? The response is, we do.
We do.
Do we agree to pray for them, to encourage them, to respect their decisions, and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church?
We do.
Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, with joy we give thanks and praise. Throughout the ages and in every place, you have chosen servants from among your people to point the way to salvation by grace. We are grateful for ancestors in the faith who followed without fear, placing their trust in you alone. For judges and monarchs who ruled in righteousness and peace. For prophets and apostles who spoke your bold words of mercy and of truth. For leaders and teachers in every age who have nurtured your faith in people and in faithfulness. Above all, we praise you for Jesus Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life to set others free. Anointed by your Holy Spirit, he proclaimed your reign on earth, revealing your saving love in all he said and did. Gracious God, we thank you for your servants, Lou, Leela, and Ryan, as they continue in the ministry in which you have called them. Help them to rely on the gift of your Spirit and to follow Christ faithfully in his calling. Give them a spirit of truthfulness, that they may show the compassion of Christ in the actions of daily living and rightly govern your people. Gracious God, pour out your Spirit and power and truth upon the church, that we may be for you a holy people baptized to serve you in the world. Sustain your church ministry, ground us in the gospel, secure our hope in Christ, strengthen our service to the outcast, and increase our love for one another. Show us the transforming power of your grace in our life together, that we may be effective servants of the gospel, offering a compelling witness in the world to the good news of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You are ruling elders, ordained to the ministry and service and governance in the Church of Jesus Christ, this congregation. Be faithful and true in your ministry, so that your whole life will bear witness to the crucified and risen Christ. Amen.
Let us welcome our returning ruling elders.
what shall we come before the Lord this day? We come with a love of justice and a passion for sharing Christ's love. Let us walk in humble gratitude, offering to God a portion of the gifts that God has freely shared with us, gifts for the healing of the world. Found in your bulletin. Let us pray. We thank you, God, that you have blessed us with an abundance of gifts for the flourishing of your world. May this offering of our life and labor reveal your love as we seek to share your promised grain with all creation. Amen. Our ascending hymn is Let There Be Peace on Earth.
Thank you.
the Beatitude. Commit to leading a life of blessing, living in compassion, simplicity, and peace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.